And we return as we're trying to get into the game as soon as possible. Let's get it underway ASAP. You should be fine as we're just going to get this party started again. Look at this world. It's pretty, isn't it? Yeah, that's the new Charlemagne world. We've added seasons to the fray, which adds all sorts of attrition mechanics to it as well. And as you can see, we're quickly rushing in to make sure that everybody can quickly join once again. As you can see, there's trailers running in the background of me. Ooh, isn't that pretty? Yeah, indeed it is. All right, so I'm ready. We're just waiting for some of these guys to get underway. We've been tweaking quite a lot with the with some of the other stuff. But yeah, how are you guys doing in the chat? Does tribal army replace getting men from your vassals? No, that's not how that works. You can raise an army out of nowhere, but as we're slowly but steadily getting ready, I think we should try to get this on the way speedy. Ah, 33 users, always fine. When will you add speed 6? Well, you can always go to plaid, as we like to call that. Charlemagne must be stopped. Well, you can totally murder the shit out of him if you really want to. Map color should be more dark, I guess. Well, maybe you should. You can always mod that if you really want to. This is what you're gonna get. But yeah, we'll just take it from the top once again, as people will try to select their rulers and all that jazz. Oh, my microphone seems to be slightly on the broken side. My apologies. As slowly but steadily getting into the game. We're only about half an hour underway, so. Show us who's in Tutorial Island. Nobody is in Tutorial Island, I'm afraid. Ireland is completely open, and there's only one. There's two people that can go in there. We have, of course, the Duke of Northumbria, or the King, the Petty King of Northumbria. And, of course, we've got Earl of Say, which is in the Pictolunt. So there's a lot of interesting things that can happen here. Both can actually move into Ireland very quickly, but of course, the king of the petty king of Wessex is down there as well, who may try to actually form the kingdom of England. We have the king Offa of Mercia, of course, here as well, or Mercia, depending on where you're from. But the Saxons, are they Saxons? They are in Anglo-Saxons, actually. But we're ready to go on the way. Let's see how this goes and. Stay breathing as we're underway. Here we go. Oh, and we're in! So the game is underway. That was actually significantly faster than I thought we would. But welcome to the game here on January 1st, 769. Let's take it from the top, shall we? As we are once again underway here in this world. And as you can see, we have a lot of our players all over the place. And like we said, we briefly touched upon Grugi. Grugi has told himself, you know what? Zunbils are awesome. They are down here. I want to become, you know, I want to become the worshipper of the sun. Let's become worshippers of the sun. So here we go. He's immediately going to go and raise his armies to get underway. So last time we stopped on January 9, 769. Let's see if we can get past January 10th. I'm happy. Let's put it that way. 8 days to go. Avaria, of course, is here as well. It does tend to fall fairly early on. It is one of those nations that is very difficult to control because Bulgaria and the Magyars are right here. And they may want to try to move in. And Hungary being formed here out of Avaria is definitely a possibility. So trying to figure out what is currently going on, as we can see Grugi immediately trying to go for the assault. And we have another one here. In Lithuania as well. We have a game. We're on the 3rd of January, 4th of January, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th. We're past it. All right, so we have ourselves a game. Let's focus our good friend here in Wessex, shall we? And so he's currently just taking himself back here in the bottom of England, as slowly but steadily, not doing his own thing, you know. He's got a couple of unlanded sons that may cause a couple of problems. He's only got one son, though. So, and he's got four domain, which is perfectly fine. You can only handle two, so giving away Somerset to your son would be perfectly okay. Yes, it is a concern to everybody, as he is trying to get married and potentially take over all these small counties here in Surrey, Kent, Sussex, maybe Devon. It's a different culture, though, so it may cause some problems. And he's immediately sent out his chancellor to fabricate claims. He's got 16.61 chance a year to actually get something going with that, but let's take a look at his claims. Doesn't have any claims in general. Let's take a look if he can make any additional claims. Doesn't appear to be case. And be the case. Has the ambition to become learned. He's going to need to. He's fairly low on that front. Lustful. He's got a... My God. That is... Well, I hope she's got vast tracts of land. Let's put it that way. Let's take a look here a little bit further north at our next ruler, the Earl Aelthred of York. Actually, we want to go for Aelthred of Northumbria because he is a player character in this particular game. And in honesty, his wife is significantly prettier. Let's put it that way. And yeah, he's pretty shitty. He's got some pretty shitty stats. He's got the titles of Petty Kingdom of Northumbria, County of Northumbria, as well as the County of Northumberland. Can usurp a title here on Strathclyde, which basically allows him to move into Pickland very early on. And speaking of Pickland, it looks like Pickland has a bit of a rebel problem on their hands right now. As is that being run here by Shams? I think it is, as Shams is trying to revolt his way into a better position here in Pickland. Not so much for the British Isles, though. We'll talk a little bit more about the British Isles later on. Let's go take a look here at West Francia. Let's take a look here at Divine, who is the Duke of Aquitaine. He's 53 years old. He's got some pretty damn good stats. Look at that intrigue. And he is quick as well, which is super awesome. Yeah, Grugi has apparently got 18 stewardship, which is pretty good as well. In the meantime, I am quickly going to chat what they want. Apparently, you can spread syphilis as the spectator. Yes, indeed, we can spread syphilis as the spectator, which is pretty cool. Fido running with triple zeros, so he's pretty bad. Got a couple of claims. Let's take a look here at current wars that are being fought. Let's take a look at the... Oh, here we go. He's got a claim on Anjou. So he can... The county of Anjou, that's fine. As everybody is just trying to make their way through the world. The Abbasids doing fine. They're going to break up very soon. They're currently programmed to have... to have a bigger impact on the world, and also that they fall apart a lot easier than they did before. When it comes to the snow, it shouldn't have any impact whatsoever on the mechanics, or at least the performance of your computer. And right now we're a little bit focused on towards Grugi here, who's managed to take his first territory. Let's take a look here at good old Grugi and see what he can do. He's got a host of raiders lost for plunder, and he's going to get a higher opinion because of that. But as you can see, he's got some pretty decent prestige, and that allows him to do a whole slew of things. He's got elective Gavelkind, which is pretty much to be expected. Low centralization, mainly because he hasn't got the legalism stuff going on with that. So let's take a look, actually, at the renewed legalism system. So legalism right now will get you limited crown authority and low centralization, whereas legalism 2 will get you medium crown authority all the way up towards, you know, vice royalties, which get unlocked at legalism 4. That, of course, is only for those people that have empires. However, if we go further on at the last one, we have duchy vice royalties, which is one of the other unlockables that you can actually have. For this particular session, I am not going to be looking at the chronicle just yet. I'm going to save that one for next week for a good reason, as we will. Right now, there's just nothing to show on towards the actual, you know, on the chronicle. This is the first year. This is what happened, and in all honesty, that's pretty much the gist of that. So what does the button to the upper left corner of the portrait do? This one right here, that is the spectate button. So basically that allows me to quickly jump into a character if I want to. However, I'm using keyboard shortcuts as I find it a little bit more effective to do it. So let's keep our eyes on Grugi here as he is just in the middle of trying to subjugate the next people here. It's actually the Illyrian subjugation over the Rus. He's trying to get some subjugation going on here, and that's three more territories that he's potentially going to add here. Let's take a look at his army. That's a 5-4. That's pretty bad. His options are not all that good, actually. His main fighter is a tough soldier, which is okay, but you're going to need to get people on those flanks that have abilities that are, you know, combat related. You need like flanker, inspiring, stuff like that, and that really gives you the upper hand if you want to do some stuff properly. How do I stop being tribal? Well, Shams just asked the most important question of all. How do I stop being tribal? So let's take a look here at towards good old Shams, as he's actually a king of Pictland, so he's actually cheating. Or unless he managed to turn himself into a king just now. So let's take a look here at Clan Cersin in the county capital. Now, as you can see here, he is on the water. So he has two options here. He can either become a feudalist monarchy, or he can have the opportunity to become a merchant republic because he is on the water. What you do there is, if we go in towards the intrigue menu, you have the opportunity to go and adopt feudalism. And there's a couple of mechanics that you need to wait for. First of all, your capital must have the one of the following. You need to be tribal. You need to have a stone hill fort in your capital. As soon as that is maxed out, you have the opportunity to do whatever you need to do in order to get on top of that. However, if you want to become a merchant republic in this particular case, all you need to do is upgrade the following to the max, which is the market village. If you max that all the way out, you have the opportunity to become a merchant republic. So you have the choice of either or one of the two if you want to, you know, develop yourself in a certain direction. You totally have that opportunity to do so coming in from a tribal nation. So right now there is a couple of small things going on here in Grugi's encampment as he is slowly but steadily trying to expand, and he's actually at a single war, and he is also doing some raiding, I think. Is he doing some raiding at the same time? I don't think this is the same. Yes, he is. He is actually raiding at the same time. So at the moment, he is trying to raid his way through Finland, getting enough money to take down all of these areas. And he's pretty much doing whatever he needs to do to become the biggest power block here within the confines of Slavic Europe. Or actually, should I say Slavic Europe? As he is actually Slavic. So there you go. That's one of the things that he is going to need to work for. In the meantime, it looks like a couple of players are looking to overthrow the Abbasids, creating something along the lines of a rebellion here, as I'm trying to switch over to the Abbasids. It's sometimes a difficult thing to do because the fog of war is fairly large over here, but let's take a look at the factions, as there is an independent factions being held by Pediak Johan as the Emir of Mosul, and the Abbasids are growing, but steadily. Johan is trying to become his own thing. The Egyptians also want to break free. And in the meantime, there we go. So we have slowly but steadily players being added towards this independent faction. And the Abbasids are going to have some serious problems with that. We saw some people in the chat early on asking, you know, what's going on with this menu? Why does it change when you switch between things? It has to do with religion. So with Islam, your menu looks a little bit more different from, say, if we go to, let's take a look at a player here. Take a look at Nuzia. Oh no, that's a desync. There's a couple of players have managed to fall out of sync. And as you can see here, our interface immediately changes. We're going to continue as those players have fallen out. But that was to be expected, as some things do happen there. But we're going to continue on with the players that we have. We've lost three, but that was to be expected with a game of 35. That was pretty much the size that we're working with. But yeah, as you can see, our interface immediately changes into a more wooden setup as we go towards a Norse religion. And of course, the Christians have a different interface, and the Hindus and all the other Indians have a different interface as well. And it's pretty much a thing that's going on here. It's a centralized theme that we have going on, and I'm sure that we're going to have different interfaces for new cultures and new religions that are being added throughout the development cycle of the game. And of course, the more you guys actually buy expansions, the more stuff we will add, because it tells us that, you know, these guys want to have more Crusader Kings, so we will give them more Crusader Kings. And that's basically incentive for us to continue to do things.